Hello and welcome to the NDTV Dialogues, a conversation of ideas. And this week's special guest is somebody fascinating to discuss ideas with because she's Gita Gopinath, Chief Economist of the International Monetary Fund, who also will soon be the first Deputy Managing Director of the IMF. Thank you very much, Dr. Gopinath, and great to have you in the Dialogues.
I'm happy to join you, Sonia.
Well, it's an interesting time to interview you because, of course, we're going now headlong, it seems, into another COVID crisis with both the United Kingdom and the United States sounding the alarm on the Omicron variant. How is the IMF, or how would you be looking at this impact in 2022?
Yes, Sonia, unfortunately, we've been living in interesting times for a bit too long, and we are very closely following what the developments on the Omicron front because we do our January World Economic Outlook update, and we have to decide whether we need to change our baseline or we think of this as a big downside risk. The short answer is we haven't settled on that yet. Mm-hmm. What we know is that cases are going up rapidly, that it seems to be, at least the recent preliminary evidence is that it's much more infectious than Delta. Now, it could be less severe than Delta, but if the numbers are that big in terms of people being infected, then that could just overwhelm the hospital system, even if a smaller fraction of people end up in hospital. And we're already seeing, of course, a reaction in terms of restrictions on travel, on mobility, and so on, which obviously has implications for the world. But, you know, how severe all of this is going to be, we are still making a determination at this point.
So you don't have a ballpark estimate on the impact, you think?
No.
In fact, interestingly, many of the lessons you would have thought that the globe would have learned that perhaps shouldn't be done, for instance, shutting down travel for certain countries, trying to contain it within borders, vaccine inequities are still very much a reality as we go into perhaps a phase two of this pandemic. As looking at it from the IMF perspective, what do you think the globe perhaps need to do now right and stop doing wrong?
You know, vaccine inequity is tragic. And the fact that we're at the end of 2021 with high-income countries having 70% of the population vaccinated and less than 4% of the population in low-income countries vaccinated is just a tragedy. You know, the targets were set to vaccinate 40% of the population in every country by the end of this year. There are about 80 countries that are not going to meet that mark. And for the vast majority of them, it's because they just don't have enough vaccine supply. Mm-hmm. For instance, on COVAX, the contracts it has with companies, only about 18% of its contracted doses have been delivered. So they've not been prioritizing the deliveries. That needs to change. The doses, donations that were pledged need to be delivered. About 1.5 billion doses have been pledged. About 300 million have been delivered so far. And countries need to be helped to be prepared so when the shots come, they can go in arm. Right. And that has to all, you know, it has to take place on a Herculean front. Now, of course, what we're seeing now is the big demand for boosters that have gone up, especially with the Omicron variant. So I am worried that we might again have a problem with getting enough supplies to low-income countries, mm-hmm. with the fact that now there will be even more of a desire to hoard vaccines at home.
Mm-hmm. And you've of course been talking on inflationary pressures and the impact on monetary policy for whether it's developed countries or emerging markets. You just met the Prime Minister as well this week. As an emerging market economy, what do you think India needs to be looking at in terms of monetary policy, given the inflationary pressures? We've just had a wholesale price inflation at a record since 1991, retail inflation rising as well. What would your recommendations be?
Globally, what we are seeing is that there are some common factors in inflation. So when you look at energy prices and you look at food prices, they were elevated. And both of them have fed into higher levels of headline inflation in many countries. Then you have had the supply chain disruptions, the supply bottlenecks, the semiconductor shortages, especially for the auto industry, which has affected all countries, including India, the auto sector in India. And imported, you know, input costs, intermediate input costs have gone up, showing up again in wholesale prices in many countries in the world. So I think these are challenging times because for many emerging and developing countries, including India, while there has been a recovery, it's not complete. There is much more that still needs, much more distance that needs to be traveled. And at the same time, you're seeing inflationary pressures. In India, you know, it's still close to the upper band. It's about core inflation is at about 6.1%, but it's sticky at that level. And so that's something you need to keep a very close eye on. And then third, the U.S. Fed is moving towards, you know, much quicker normalization, very likely increase in interest rates next year, multiple rounds. So that should also then tighten global financial conditions. So from an emerging market perspective, you're going to have to manage these three pieces, which is support the recovery, be vigilant on inflation, and make sure that the financial house is in order as financial conditions tighten. For India, we think it remains appropriate to keep monetary policy somewhat accommodative in the near term. But, you know, if inflation starts going up, and especially inflation expectations show signs of serious de-anchoring, then it's important for to move more aggressively on monetary policy front.
How did the meeting with the Prime Minister go? It's interesting, of course, so this is a government which has really pushed through many reforms in these last 2 years, the lockdown years as it were, but had to turn its back on farm laws and the reforms there because of domestic opposition. That's always an interesting balance. And how was the meeting with the Prime Minister?
It was an excellent meeting with the Prime Minister. There is a lot to worry about in the world right now with the pandemic, with what's happening with inflation, you know, with climate financing, you know, climate challenges, which is another big issue that is also a big risk on the plate right now. And also looking ahead, you know, India is going to have the G20 presidency in 2023, which, you know, which would make India very prominent on the world stage in terms of handling the G20. So we touched on all these different issues.
Not on reforms and getting them through?
No, we also talked about the multiple kinds of reforms that have been undertaken in India. And, you know, a lot has been done. I think this is definitely was a crisis that was not, you know, was used to kind of push through a lot of reforms. But again, as we all know, there is more recovery that's needed. And also, you know, the recovery has come through, but there is unevenness in the recovery. If you look at labor markets, haven't healed yet. If you look at MSMEs, they still need, you know, the recoveries are still weaker. So, you know, but this is a challenge countries are facing everywhere.
No, and of course, and as you know well, of course, having from India and having studied in India, that poverty is always the huge issue here, and India had great success in lifting a large number of millions out of the poverty line index, and now worries about people slipping back and job losses. Is that something which is the focus of the IMF, especially in countries like India?
You know, that is an unfortunate you know, effect of this pandemic, which is the gains that were made in poverty reduction. Some of that was reversed last year. In terms of at least people's access to incomes and jobs. You know, in many countries, lots of support was provided in terms of cash transfers, you know, even in India, cash transfers and food grains. So that helped. But, you know, what we are worried about is that if the pandemic keeps going on, like, you know, the way it has in the last 2 years, then most governments don't have the fiscal space to continue to provide large amounts of support. So I think it's going to become more challenging. It has to be much more targeted, and you know, use your limited resources to make sure that it goes to the most vulnerable in the population. And given the global finite, like I said, because interest rates are going to go up in the U.S. and in other advanced economies, it's important also to have very good medium-term fiscal consolidation plans. So it's very clear that the economy is on a good trajectory on a fiscal basis. Reserves, having a large amount of reserves, which India does have, also helps. So yeah, you're going to have to manage these trade-offs. But it is the fact that poorer households, you know, more vulnerable households have been deeply affected is a big concern.
As I said, it's an interesting time also to interview you when you were heading back to Harvard, and now you're staying on at the IMF with that huge new promotion. In fact, it's wonderful that the two top positions at the IMF will be held by women economists. Now, that's a huge change, because often you must have been the only woman economist in a room, you and your counterparts. That's changing. What was it like for you? Has it been a challenging journey to reach here?
It's been challenging, yes. You know, it's been exhilarating in some sense, too. I am a workaholic, so I don't complain about being awake at all hours. And the, you know, the last 2 years have been intense. You know, originally I thought I would be going back to Harvard and resume my academic life, which would be at a slower pace. But just given where the world is and given all the stresses that are still there, I just thought I should stay on in public service for some time longer. And, you know, it's going to be, these are going to be very challenging times for sure on multiple fronts.
It is interesting to be called a trailblazer, role model for young women, especially Indian young women, because you've had the trajectory of course, studying in Mysuru, then LSR and D school. So a huge inspiration for so many young Indian women out there. What would you tell them?
Well, I, first of all, it's very kind that somebody says that. I'm always, whenever I hear it, I'm like, wow, that's very nice of people to say that. But, you know, it is true. I grew up in Mysore. I went to Nirmala Convent in Mahajana's college and took my first class in economics in Lady Sri Ram College. So, you know, I hope my story is something that says that, you know, you could come from pretty ordinary backgrounds, and if you set your mind to accomplishing things, that it can happen.
I read a lovely interview with your parents where your father, like all Indian parents, said you were a pretty average student till you were in junior school, and your mother said you still make time to call her every day. So in that sense, it's a nice time also for us to be, as Indian journalists, to see so many Indian origin CEOs shattering many ceilings, tech companies, the Chanel CEO, and of course, IMF chief economist as well. What do you think is driving Indians to do so well in these global positions right now?
Well, I think there are lots of talented Indians around the world, and we are large in numbers, so we also will show up at a global stage. But, you know, I think we're all extremely thankful for, at least I can speak for myself, I'm extremely thankful for the education I had in India, the fact that your parents put a huge priority on it, my parents put a huge priority on my education, and, you know, just dreaming for the best possible. So. You know, I think
it's wonderful that in that sense, when you talk about global openness, that there's opportunities also available to immigrants in other countries, and it's just merit-based. I think that's a huge impact as well. And also just the point when we look at global and this bit about closing of borders and restrictions, is the IMF going to come up with some kind of recommendations perhaps on more openness when we're looking at economic impact of what shutting down borders often has?
Right. So, I mean, of course, decisions of shutting down borders are tied to health-related issues, and we leave that to the WHO to comment on. But our view has been that when it comes to global trade, that it is important to, you know, not put restrictions on vaccine exports or exports of, medical equipment and so on. You know, trade has actually held up very well. So now we are seeing the supply chain disruptions and so on. But that's partly a reflection of the fact that demand for goods has grown very strongly at a time when people cannot spend on services, where they're not traveling, where they're not, you know, going to large stadiums and attending events like that. So people are purchasing a lot of things online. And so there's a huge demand that's being placed on the World Trade Network, and that is leading to disruptions. But I think, you know, it's been a big source of strength for the economy in terms of, you know, having an integrated global system, which is something we always push for.
For India, somehow our benchmark, our competition is always looking at how can we occupy space which China perhaps has. And we looked at India, of course, the IMF, and at a function in LSR, the then IMF chief had described India as the bright spot in globally challenging economies in the world. Do you still see India at that position, or where do you see India now?
For many countries, these are difficult years. I mean, being hit by a pandemic and the recovery that comes after that, I mean, these are incredibly challenging times. We are seeing recoveries. In the case of India, I do think that the potential remains in terms of a large young labor force. Of course, there are challenges that are still there in terms of making sure that they have the right skills and can therefore get the right kind of employment. The large English speaking population. I mean, all of these are, you know, have been traditionally touted as the strengths for India, which remain. There have been new reforms that have been going on are also encouraging. The privatization of Air India, I think, has been a very good step in that direction. So there are reforms happening. But, you know, we have to keep in mind that even before the pandemic, there was slowing growth in India. And so, you know, the question is to ensure that coming out of the pandemic, there's robust enough growth in India. I don't think that can be taken for granted. But, you know, it is one of the absolute engines of growth in the world.
Mm-hmm. one of the axioms in India has always been that good economics is bad politics. Do you think that's going to play out as well when, I mean, we've got elections coming up, so do you think that you're going to see a slowdown, or what would you, how does reforms make good politics?
Well, I mean, firstly, I don't think it's necessarily that good economics is bad politics. So, for instance, in this pandemic, it was very important to make sure that you were supporting people and firms in terms of also in terms of cash transfers, providing support to small enterprises, loans, and so on. All of that was both good economics and, I guess, politically good too.
Making sure
free food, the health spending in the health sector. More will be needed on that front, on spending on health and spending on education, even in especially in India also. So that will be needed. So that's not an issue. We have studied, though, the problems that come with trying to do reforms that are much more trickier, like labor market reforms. And it's certainly the case that those are much harder to do at a time when the economy has not fully recovered. And it's easier to do when there is strength in Europe, you have a booming economy. So timing is definitely important in terms of when you roll out certain reforms.
How worried are you about the impact of online education, especially in India, where the digital divide is so stark in the access that children have to devices to access remote education? Do you think we're going to see a huge impact on that, especially in India?
I'm very worried about that. I saw some recent studies from ASARD, the evaluations that were done in terms of reading capabilities and math capabilities, and that has taken a hit. So, 2 years of children not having proper access to education is very costly. And these are the future labor force, for the future human capital for the country. So I think there's absolutely action needs to be taken to make sure that this is remedied. I am quite worried about it.
And finally, Gita Gopinath, if you had three things to say, you met the Prime Minister already, but if you had three things to tell the Indian government right now on how to get on track now with another COVID potential crisis booming. Luckily, our cases are down right now, but who knows, what would they be?
Well, I think first, which again is true for all countries, is to make sure that you are doing your vaccinations on a war footing. Mm-hmm. India is at about, in terms of a share of the total population, it's about 37% of the population that's fully vaccinated. Of course, that number in terms of first dose is much higher, closer to 60%. But what we see around the world is that when vaccine cases come down, pressure comes off, people, don't think about getting vaccinated. So getting over vaccine hesitancy and just on a war footing, pushing through much higher rates of vaccination, I think is essential. It's not going to solve the problem. I mean, you're still going to get infections. You're seeing that in the UK, even with higher levels of vaccination rates. But everything points to the fact that even with Omicron, if you are vaccinated, you get some protection against severe disease and death. And that's what we should be, targeting. So I think that's one big area. The second area is recovery. Like we said, there has been recovery. We've seen it after Delta. There's been a rebound after the reopening. But it's not done. It's not complete. There's still a big gap between where India would have been in the absence of the pandemic and where it is. So there is still need to keep in the near term fiscal and monetary policy accommodative. But at the same time, you communicate how you are going to consolidate over the medium term. So kind of very clearly, how would you bring the fiscal house in order over the medium term? Similarly, for monetary policy side, keeping a very close eye on inflation. I guess we talk so much of the health crisis, infection and inflation get mixed up now. So, and then the last thing is there are lots of long-standing issues that have to continue to be addressed, making sure there's sufficient spending on health, on education. India's done well in terms of investment in physical infrastructure and digital infrastructure, but there is much more that's needed. And of course on climate change. Big announcements have been made. But that will require very ambitious policies to attain those targets.
Gita Gopinath, thank you so much for being on NDTV. We look forward to the IMF's January economic outlook. Thank you.
Thank you, Sonia.
Thank you.